Hola Dunya, Agus Falche. Good morning, everyone, and welcome. This is the third meeting of 2021 of the Justice Subcommittee on Policing, and we have no apologies. Agenda item one is a decision to take item three, the review of the evidence heard today, and item four on considering a draft report in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, thank you. We're also considering whether any further drafts of our reports on remote piloted aircraft systems and body-worn cameras should be taken in private at future meetings. Are we agreed on that as well? We are agreed. Thank you very much indeed. Excuse me. Our main item of business is an evidence session on the impact on policing in Scotland of the United Kingdom's withdrawal from the European Union. This session follows on from our last session on this topic on 26 October 2020. And can I refer members to paper one, which is a note by the clerk, and paper two, which is a private paper. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting today. Deputy Chief Constable Will Kerr, Local Policing, and Assistant Chief Constable Patrick Campbell, Organised Crime, Counter-Terrorism and Intelligence at East Scotland. And I invite the Deputy Chief Constable Kerr to make some brief opening remarks, please, Mr Kerr.
Thank you and good morning, Convener, and good morning to other members of the Subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to come along and to engage with the Subcommittee again on evidence of this important issue. I suppose my evidence in October was largely characterised by uncertainty as we awaited the terms of our withdrawal from the European Union. And we were working at that stage on the basis of what we called the reasonable worst case scenarios. And that gave us sort of the worst plausible risks that we could work to. Fortunately, a lot of those haven't turned out to be the case. And the law enforcement tools that we spent a lot of time talking about in the last session, some of those had a relatively straightforward solution in the end through the negotiated settlement, some less so. No doubt we'll get into that in a bit of detail. But on the 24th of December 2020, when the UK government announced the negotiated outcome, it left only a matter of days for us to prepare for issuing both fast-track guidance to our officers and staff. Our International Bureau worked 24/7 over that two-week period of the EU exit, and our Brexit delivery team also provided an on-call facility to support the force. Like everything else, we had to run that alongside the continuing response and challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic that undoubtedly continues to mask the full effect of Brexit. Police Scotland's submission to the subcommittee highlighted the fact that we're still very much in the early stages of understanding the impact of the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. To date, minimal detriment to operations, but there's a number of caveats to that. First, a couple of basic points that might help with some questions from the committee. We've maintained very strong relationships with both across the United Kingdom and with our international partners. We've retained our seconded detective inspectors, both with Europol in The Hague and Interpol in Lyon, and that's been massively beneficial to us. We were and remain worried that we could end up with slower, more bureaucratic processes, which have replaced our previous access arrangements, the Justice and Home Affairs measures. And whilst we've uplifted our International Bureau to help to try and mitigate that, we simply won't know until we see how some of these measures work in practice. So, for example, the complete loss of the Schengen Information System is a significant loss to law enforcement and the United Kingdom as a whole. We've replaced it, and we're trying to mitigate that in some part with Interpol red notices, but that won't be quite as good or quite as fast. We're still working during a three-month period of grace with the EU, where they permitted us to conclude existing inquiries only using the SIS2, the Schengen Information System. There's a number of ongoing legal challenges to the United Kingdom in respect of extradition and the European arrest warrant. They will take some time to get resolved. Data adequacy is also an issue that impacts across all justice and home affairs issues, and a draft decision was published just to show you how this is still an ongoing iterative process, Convener, on the 17th of February, just a couple of Thursdays ago, and data negotiations and data adequacy are still subject to a six-month bridging capability, so there's still a lot of details to be finalised there. And whilst we are working through the impact of the Trade and Cooperation Agreement, so with all the other EU member states, and obviously they're having to build that into their domestic law as well. I'm not going to go into detail in the interest of brevity, Convener, on our arrangements around civil contingencies. Very happy to answer questions if we want. I would just say that I previously said I think our arrangements in Scotland are as good as I've seen, and that's been proven over the last couple of months around civil contingencies, right from the macro level, from the Scottish Government Resilience Room right down to the 32 local resilience partnerships. But I would conclude by saying this, that whilst my last two evidence sessions I've talked about the importance of temperate language, if I could just add in the bit of the importance of public patience now. We are entering, we are now in a very, what's going to be a very event-rich 2021 for Police Scotland. And whilst my evidence the last time might have been characterised by a bit of uncertainty, this time I think it's characterised by those two very important things. Firstly, concurrency, there's just a lot going on in Scotland at the moment. And secondly, by the need for adaptability and flexibility by the police service. So I'll stop at that point, convener. I'm very happy to take any questions and thank you for the opportunity for some opening remarks.
Thank you very much indeed, DCC Kerr. And I can also thank all the witnesses who have provided written evidence to the committee, as ever, it's very helpful. But before we move to questions, can I remind members to indicate who their question is for and to remind all attendees to wait just a moment for your microphone to be activated before speaking. Mr. Kerr, the first question is to yourself. I have the first couple of questions, and thank you for these opening remarks. Are you able to provide a very general overview of engagement that's taken place with EU counterparts since 1st of January? Just a very general overview, if you could, please.
Yes, Convener, thank you. And I might ask, if you don't mind, ACC Campbell, to add a wee bit of flavour, just to answer the question fully. But yeah, there's ongoing arrangements, both through, particularly through the seconded detective inspector out in The Hague, but we also, we're lucky in Scotland in that we have a significant number of bilateral relationships with European law enforcement partners, and we've been able to use those to good effects. But perhaps, with your indulgence, I'll ask Pat to put a wee bit of practical flavour to that.
Indeed, Mr. Campbell.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, committee. Yeah, in respect of the engagement, as the DCC indicated, that's on a daily basis with our counterparts within Europol and within Interpol at this stage. We do engage with the EU member states regularly. For example, European arrest warrant was activated in Spain recently. So through our counterparts and law enforcement in Spain, as well as through from Crown Office side, we have that ongoing engagement, such as we have an alert or we have an arrest warrant activated in the respective EU member state. We also have the continued engagement with Home Office in respect of the Internal Security Board, which both Police Scotland and Crown Office and Scottish Government sit on. So we have that engagement through into the UK Government aspect of it as well, but we still have that very good relationship with law enforcement across the European Union.
Thanks for that, Mr. Campbell. At an early stage in the Brexit negotiations, the UK and the EU recognised that there would be a mutual interest in law enforcement maintaining cooperation as far as possible. It's heartening to hear of the example you've given. Do you get the sense that EU partners are as keen to maintain that nature of that level of cooperation?
Certainly, from a law enforcement perspective, that relationship maintains and is very strong across the EU member states. So, law enforcement to law enforcement, we still have that appetite for that mutual cooperation and continued engagement in respect to that. So that's certainly not in any way has been reduced by the position we find ourselves in just now.
Thanks, Mr. Campbell. And just maybe push a little bit further with that. But I presume it's perhaps a bit too early to say whether that cooperation would extend to judicial matters as such.
Yeah, I think there is an understanding that the negotiated outcome has resulted in suboptimal measures been put in place across a number of the different areas. There's no getting away from that. I think what we've got just now, the early stages, is that operationally, it has had limited operational negative impact on law enforcement at this stage, from what we can see. As I say, some of the contingency planning, the measures which have now been put in place, such as the loss of the European arrest warrant and the framework that's been put in place around that, has resulted in the continued aspect of arrests both in Scotland and across the EU member states at this stage.
Thank you. That's very helpful and indeed reassuring. With members have questions, including those on the European arrest warrant. Our next series of questions are from Rona Mackay. Rona, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and good morning. My question would be to DCC Wilcare, I think, and it's a fairly general one, to say that, you know, it goes without saying that Police Scotland can only operate and carry out functions where there's clarity around the law and the legal procedures under which it operates. Are you satisfied that you're operating with sufficient clarity as things stand, or are there any areas of concern which still need to be addressed? And if there are, which of those is the most significant?
Thank you. Yeah, we're still waiting. As I commented on my introductory comments, we're still waiting. There's still some ongoing legal challenges. There's still some issues around data adequacy that will take a wee bit of time to resolve. But maybe the best way I could describe this, we've sort of got three groups of justice and home affairs measures. But with those which are new arrangements, so certainly the extradition, a new fast track arrangement that replaced the European arrest warrant, that's largely the same capabilities that existed before. Mutual legal assistance, again, largely we've retained access to a European investigation order, which is great, that's what we want. And asset freezing and confiscation, that's the first category. We've then got categories where we retain capability but under new provisions. I'll not go through these in detail, but that includes Europol, Eurojust, passenger name records, what we call PNR, PRIM, which is exchange of biometric data, largely DNA and fingerprints, and access to criminal records. That they will take a bit of time to develop practically how exactly we can use those. And then thirdly, there's a loss of access, which is a law enforcement alerts under the Schengen Information System. So those broadly, to answer your question, are the three areas. The first area is relatively straightforward with a reasonable sense of, albeit it will still be subject to some judicial scrutiny and challenge and domestic laws and the other European member states. But the middle group where we've retained capability under new provisions, those provisions will undoubtedly need to be tested both judicially and practically. So it's impossible to give an accurate answer to that question. But if we go back to the question that the convener asked at the beginning, what gives us some encouragement and some hope is the fact that all our other European member states' law enforcement agencies want this to work and need this to work as much as we do. And I think that's encouraging. Certainly, police service to police service, law enforcement agency to law enforcement agency, but there still isn't complete clarity on how they will work in practice.
Yeah. Thank you for the answer. Is there a sense that there's some sort of temporary nature about this, that you're doing absolutely everything you can at the moment, but in the back of your mind is, you know, that things could change and you know, there is an element of this being temporary? And how well understood are the guidelines amongst the, you know, the rank and file force? You know, are they fairly confident that about what they can and can't do now?
Yeah, it's a very good question. I think we are both temporary to an extent by transition, in that we're still, for example, in the D23 months, which takes us right up to the 31st of March 2021, the D20 being the new name for Yellowhammer, the reasonable worst case scenario, although fortunately we haven't seen most of those actually materialise, thank goodness, albeit still masked by COVID and temporary because of COVID. It's hard to get a true sense of what the full or long impact is going to be. But your question specifically with the frontline, we've spent a lot of time and a lot of work, even with that abridged period between Christmas Eve and the 31st of December last year, getting the instructions out. We've done a lot of preparatory work in 2020, as you would expect. And actually, frontline officers doesn't affect a great deal. It mostly affects a lot of our specialist teams who've been working with Pat and Gerd Kosh. And we're very confident that they're absolutely all over what they do.
Thank you. Thank you. That's helpful. That's me, Convener.
Thank you, Rona. Our next series of questions are from Shona Robison. Shona, please.
Thank you, Convener. So we've already touched on the European arrest warrant issues in general. So it would be helpful, perhaps, starting with Mr. Kerr, just to give us a little bit more detail around where things are in respect of those new arrangements. And you know, you talked about retained capability under new provisions. Can you just tell us a little bit more around the detail of the European arrest warrant alternative provisions?
Yes, very happy to. I mean, there were two things that we were concerned about and on the new fast track arrangement that would be the replacement for the European arrest warrant. First was mandated time limits for surrender to make sure that if there was a need to get people back into the United Kingdom and back into Scotland quickly, we could do that. And secondly was the immediate power of arrest. And because we've embedded what's called this Norway Iceland arrangement, we've been able to retain both in the new fast track arrangement that's replaced the European arrest warrant. So EAW is issued before before the 31st of December, of course, are still valid up until the 1st of January 2021, still valid in the UK and the EU member states. So we have that sort of transitional period for ones that have already been issued. But perhaps just to answer your question practically as well, I can ask Pat just to give you a sense, not an awful lot of operational detail as you'll expect, but a wee bit of a sense of how it's worked over the last couple of weeks. That helps.
Yes, that would be.
Thanks, DCC. Yeah, it's working relatively well. Just now, I think what we have, the European arrest warrant, which worked really well for law enforcement in Scotland, a significant number of arrests across the EU and also within Scotland for our member state colleagues. The new system basically follows the principles and the framework of the European arrest warrant, so it is a warrant-based system. We have experienced examples of that. The first couple of days of January this year, we arrested a male, a Polish male in Glasgow. Now, that was successful. The alert activated on our police systems. He was subsequently arrested, and thereafter, the extradition back into Poland took place. There has been an appeal in respect to that, which is ongoing just now. And likewise, in the European Union, we've subsequently arrested a male in Spain, as indicated earlier, and also a further male in Poland, based on the new warrant-based system. So again, that's activated through the systems that have now been put in place and has been successful. Again, there are legal appeals against the two in Spain and Poland ongoing just now. So how that plays out and the process for the legal position on that will be established over the coming months. But in respect of operationally and our ability to keep the communities of Scotland safe, the European arrest warrant and the replacement for it has worked well at this particular stage. As the DCC indicated, warrants issued prior to the 31st of December under the term of retained European arrest warrants are still live and active just now, so we can still utilise those at this particular stage. So, as I say, operationally, it appears to be working well at this stage.
So, just for clarification, then, those that were being executed up to the 31st of December are still being executed under those previous arrangements of the arrest warrant. That's helpful. Just in terms of the extradition processes, then, I mean, what you've said there is that the operational issues are being managed quite well, but the legal system, the law surrounding it, you've talked about the appeals that are ongoing. Do you have any concerns that that those will be will run into any difficulties under new arrangements that previously weren't, or is that still to be tested in essence because we're so early in the process?
Yeah, it's still to be tested. So the first appeal hearing is on the 8th of March at Edinburgh Sheriff Court. So hopefully we'll get a better understanding at that stage exactly what the legal position is. We anticipated that there would be challenges in respect of the new framework. Any new piece of legislation that comes through, that undoubtedly going to be legal challenges in respect to that. But operationally, the activation on police systems across the EU and in the UK, the new system has worked relatively well.
So these legal challenges wouldn't have happened previously. They're happening now because of an attempt to test the robustness of the system. So that's quite important then, isn't it, in terms of what the outcome to that is in that test case, I would assume.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's a number of challenges ongoing across the UK through law enforcement. It's not just in Scotland at this stage. So, as I say, the landscape of how that plays out and what comes from that will be established over the coming months.
I think it would be helpful to hear back from you in the light of the information arising from those test cases. I think that will be really helpful for the committee or the subsequent committee potentially. As these cases go through the courts. Convener, I think that's kind of explored really the areas of questioning under the European arrest warrant, unless anyone else wants to come in.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Shona. I agree an important issue and updated information would be on these appeals would be helpful. Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Can I ask, perhaps in the first instance yourself, Mr. Kerr, about the issue of data exchange. You alluded to, or it was alluded to in the answer to Rowan earlier, and the agreement has been reached on the issue of automatic exchange of fingerprint, vehicle registration and DNA, and also the passenger name records, which is information about passengers on airlines when reserving flights or indeed checking in. Can you outline the importance of retaining these arrangements, please?
Yes, I certainly can, Convener. I mean, they're critical for lifetime policing operations, but also for retrospective investigations. So, you know, people travelling, of course, we need to know whether to, sometimes for investigative reasons, whether travelling to, for what purpose, at what time, and what flight, to what country. So those things are critically important. But even the exchange of information under EGRIS, the European Criminal Records Information System, or PRIM, which is more for biometric data, it sometimes can make or break a serious crime case. So actually, all of these things are critically important. Being able to share them with partners in lifetime is really is critical. And that's why, once we will feel the loss of the Schengen Information System. Schengen Information System was about real-time alerts. So not just about the exchange of live information, you know, case information or biometric data, but sometimes when it comes to Schengen information too, that was over 60 million nominal alerts in that system.
We are coming on to questions on that, Mr. Kerr. Yes, thank you very much indeed. And the PRUM framework then, is this arrangement for data exchange entirely in line with that? Is there any deviation at all?
Well, no, under PRIM, fortunately, what we retain is the ability for reciprocal automated searching of the EU police systems relating to DNA fingerprints and in the future VRM vehicle registration mark data. So that's been one of those areas where categorised as retained capability under new provisions.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. And indeed, the next series of questions are on the Schengen Information System, and they're from the Deputy Convener, Margaret Mitchell. Margaret, please.
Thank you, Convener, and this is to Mr. Kerr. Mr. Kerr, I know at the outside that you're saying the public has to be patient, and I think that's absolutely right. I think it's encouraging what you said this morning, but when I was looking over some of the notes, I was quite conscious of all the acronyms. Very good bodies in place, like you know, the Brexit team within Police Scotland and all of these things. It would be good maybe to get a good handle on these and for the key ones to be perhaps made available to the public for their understanding. That's just a comment in passing. However, in terms of Schengen, we know the deal which has been secured means that Police Scotland will no longer have access to Schengen information. Clearly, this does leave a gap. Can you expand on the statement? I suppose this is getting a little bit to my original point. This gap has been mitigated by the increased use of Interpol notices and the diffusion and potential future utilisation of the International Law Enforcement Alert Platform. In layman's language, what does that mean, Mr. Kerr?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. We certainly love our acronyms in policing, and when you add that against 27 other member states, that's a lot of acronyms, I have to say. So, if I deal with your question in two parts, Deputy Convener, first of all, what have we actually retained in terms of law enforcement alerts and what will the replacement under the Interpol arrangements actually mean? And hopefully I can explain this in reasonable layperson's terms. Please stop me if I don't. So the EU, as you'll remember during the negotiations, insisted that there was no legal basis for the retention, for the UK to retain access to SIS 2, the second generation SIS. So we're relying solely on European member states making better use of the Interpol system to share their circulations with the UK. But just to give you a wee bit of practical flavour on that, the Interpol is 197 member states. Now, obviously, we deal with those alerts in two ways through Interpol, either through what's called a red notice, because out to all 197 member states, as you can imagine, that takes a bit longer than going out by 27, or what's called a diffusion, which is more geographically limited. If there's an investigative reason only to deal with, you know, Southeast Asia or Western Europe or North America. So either way, whilst the Interpol system is very good, and I have a meeting with the executive director of Interpol on Thursday to discuss this and a range of other issues, it's not as good as what existed before with lifetime alerts under the Schengen Information System. So I hope that gives you a wee bit of a flavour. We are confident that over time we'll be able to build up a more expedient a system using the Interpol, both red notices and diffusions, but that's going to take a wee bit of time. And in the meantime, the experience for law enforcement simply won't be there, won't be as good as what existed under SIS 2. And there's no point trying to say otherwise.
Yeah, that's really helpful. I think this diffusion idea, from that I'm taking it that you look at the 197 member states that we're looking at, and in a way that's good in that we've got a wider range, but more problematic in trying to deal with it. And you're saying that if the issue is related to a certain geographical area, you can, you know, take that out of the equation and try and communicate with the people within Interpol that are involved with that particular incident. Would that be an accurate interpretation of how that would work?
Yes, it would be, Deputy Convener. That's exactly how it would work. But as I said before, sometimes as a function of scale and size and the fact that we're dealing globally as opposed to just European, these things can take a wee bit longer. So we are having to develop the efficacy of both the red notices and diffusions to catch up with what SIS 2 automatically gave us.
Yeah. And is there an issue too about member states, wherever they are, just ensuring or having to ensure that changes are put into the domestic law to facilitate the new operations?
Yes, there are, and also just sometimes what countries we want to share information with 197 member states, you will understand there's a range of different equities at play across all those member states. But yes, I think that's a reasonable characterisation as well.
Okay. And just finally, you've touched already on, it is an important issue, the live real-time exchange of information between yourselves and EU partners. Is a crucial aspect, and I suppose that applies for Interpol too, having that in place under, you know, through 197 member states is excellent. Can you see how that's being progressed to the point where hopefully it can actually be that lifetime information being supplied?
Well, I suppose the difficulty is when you put information out through a red notice or a diffusion, you're then dependent on 97 member states, or such a fusion, however many there may be, 13, 15, 20, if it's regionally based, coming back in, having checked their systems. So automatically the system is inherently slower than what exists through a central system that involved then 27, you know, EU member states. That was just, you could put on literally, and as I said at the beginning, there were some, as we left the system, some 60 million nominal based alerts on SIS 2, and you get a real time hit back. You get literally within 10 minutes, you'd be told if somebody who you were looking for in Perth or Cairn Ryan was actually in Poland or in France. The process will inevitably be a bit more burdensome than us and a bit slower as a result of having to go through a process and a check either up to 197 times.
Right. Can I just finally say that, you know, looking through the background paper that we've given, you know, I couldn't help
by being absolutely impressed with what Police Scotland has done to put in place a contingency plan, to look at the risk of the worst case scenario and try and anticipate that and what you would do. And I think that's largely why we seem to be in a place where we've got quite a degree of optimism going forward. So thank you very much for that. That's me, convener.
Excuse me. Thank you, Margaret. Our next questions are from Rona Mackay. Rona, please.
Thank you, convener. Yes, can I just echo what the deputy convener said there? I think the work that's been done is very impressive indeed. And just to follow up on some of the comments and that, without trying to labour the point, are you confident that the planning that you're doing now to mitigate the loss of SIS2 will be will fully replicate, you know, what that actually stood for? Do you think that there will be disadvantages, however much planning you do?
Thank you. The short and simple answer is no. It will never fully replicate what we have under SIS2. It will be slower. Will be more bureaucratic. Will be slightly more burdensome on us. We're just going to have to try and mitigate that risk as best we can.
Okay, thank you. That's fine, convener. Just a brief question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Rona, our next question is from Fulton McGregor. Fulton, please.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. It's following on, actually, from Rona Mackay and Margaret Mitchell's questions there, and talking a wee bit about that engagement that you've mentioned with Europol. Can you tell us a wee bit more about what that engagement currently looks like, and I suppose what outcomes are being sought? And following on, you know, directly from Rona Mackay's question there, you know, have you got any confidence that the ongoing engagement will be able to replicate the strength of the previous relationships with EU partners? And I guess if not, to what extent do you think that it might be able to do that? Thanks.
Thank you. If I could separate my answer out, probably in two halves around Europol in particular. So we've retaining access as a third party is in many respects great. It allows us to retain the vast majority of our current capability and allows the UK to maintain what's called liaison bureau status. And Pat can give you a bit more practical flavour in a moment on that. So in many respects, it's great. But on the other side of the house, we're not a member of Europol now, so we lose a sense of influence over the future direction and priorities of Europol that we would have had before. And certainly in broader UK terms, the UK was a big player into Europol and would have been a very influential player and partner as well. So we've lost that. So we've retained the capabilities, but we don't have as much influence and we certainly don't have as much voice. And perhaps, with your indulgence, if I could ask Pat that, a wee bit of practical favour that as to what that might mean in practice for us.
Thanks, Deb. Yeah, so we have maintained our presence there. So we've got a detective inspector based over in Europol just now. A UK liaison bureau has been maintained, as indicated now, having third country status over there. However, essentially what we do have the presence there, which is really, really important. So as well as the other EU states resident within the Europol building in The Hague. Any inquiries that we have are still channeled through Europol. So if it's an inquiry such as Romania or France, we're doing a lot of work with the French just now, just around about the preparation for the climate conference, for example. So a lot of the work we're doing with Europol is still channeled through that relationship we have with UK law enforcement within The Hague is really, really significant, and we've maintained that. So again, that fast time response and information sharing is still present there. The impact is that we are excluded from a number of the various forums within Europol in respect of the kind of voting conventions as such. But having that presence is still significant to allow that ongoing operational engagement to continue.
Okay, thanks for that, both for that thorough answer. That's me for just now, convener. I've got another question that may be appropriate later towards the end around the flexible response unit, but I'm happy to pass back to you just now.
Thank you very much indeed, Fulton. Our next questions are from Rhoda Grant. Rhoda, please.
Thank you, convener. you let the committee know previously that you were looking at some civil contingency preparations. Could I ask what you tested as part of that and what the outcome was, and whether you then needed to test other contingencies given the deal that was reached with the EU?
Yes, of course. To give a bit of flavour as to what we did in Scotland around civil contingency, we probably took a slightly, I would say, better approach. I would say this on behalf of Scotland, of course, but a slightly better approach in terms of what some of our colleagues in England and Wales did around how we translated the reasonable worst-case scenario. And as we said earlier on, the reasonable worst-case scenarios are that it's not a prediction, it's a set of the worst plausible risks. But obviously, the last 10, 11 months now have told us that actually that's a narrower band of definition post-pandemic. We would never have thought some of this stuff would have happened in February last year. So actually, the arrangements in Scotland were based on what's called an all-risk approach, that we could have lots of stuff happening over the winter at once. It could be weather-based, it could be you know, a range of other protest-based, it could be pandemic-based. And actually, we stood up what's called the National Coordination Centre, soft launch on the 7th of December last year, formally set up, properly set up on the 28th of December, and that's still running from 7 a.m. to 11 p.m. at night, with on-call facility in between. But just to give a wee bit of practical flavour about what some of the civil contingencies have been able to do because of that reach from Scottish Government level right down through the local resilience partnerships. We talked the last time about some concerns around Cairn Ryan and about what we were going to do if there was a significant overflow of freight at Cairn Ryan Port. What we'd set up was called managed through the Dumfries and Galloway Local Resilience Partnership, Operation Overflow, which effectively took over Castle Kennedy Airfield and provided a significant amount of capacity, additional capacity if that was needed. It wasn't, and that's now been stood down. But that involved Transport Scotland, who actually obviously procured and serviced the site, and a range of other partners coming together through those local resilience partnerships to make sure that we could address those all risks at once. So additional freight to Cairn Ryan, could have been bad weather at the same time, all the ongoing residual impacts of managing the pandemic. I think the approach that's been taken here has been a very sensible one, which is anything could happen, and that let's plan for all happening at once. And then if that doesn't happen, at least we can stand some of the capabilities and some of the assets down.
Okay, thank you for that. I mean, that along with other things such as illegal fishing, can border violations were things that I think people were anticipating, and something I suppose close to my own heart, people trafficking as well might be an issue. Were there any incidences relating to Brexit that you can report along those lines? I think we were aware of some issues with regard to fishing. And have you any intelligence of whether or not there are likely to be others or an increase indeed in those kind of violations?
Not a significant amount of information that I can share with this committee or subcommittee at this stage around violations. But as I said at the beginning, the pandemic is masking a lot of this issue because the amount of movements have just been significantly less. But probably there are two specific points in relation to your query. The first round, people-based trafficking is a really critical point. And certain organised crime gangs now have moved, and we've seen them develop over the last 5 years, where they're more and more interested in people-based commodities. You know, drugs you can sell once and make a profit out once. A vulnerable person can be trafficked and repeatedly exploited, and they can make repeated money from them. That's something that causes us a significant amount of concern about the movement of vulnerable people across borders and within Scotland. The other issue probably to touch on is just our ongoing concerns, and we're spending a significant amount of time just understanding and keeping an eye on the impact of this bit of the Northern Ireland Protocol. There have been a number of issues that members will be aware of in Northern Ireland, staff being removed from ports in Belfast and Aran, then put back again. Their response generally of loyalism and the loyalist community within Northern Ireland, and that's something we haven't seen any of that play out in the west coast of Scotland yet, but we're keeping a really, really close eye on it, very close contact with the police service of Northern Ireland.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Rona. Our next questions are from Liam MacArthur. Liam, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, colleague. That's a perfect segue, DCC Care, to the line of questioning I wanted to do around the issue of mutual aid. But obviously, during the negotiation process, there was a considerable amount of focus on the potential impact on the border between Ireland and Northern Ireland. You know, the way that the negotiations developed, perhaps that issue has played out a little differently than was perhaps anticipated when you were last before the committee. But it would be useful to understand what engagement you've talked about, the discussions that have been with colleagues in Northern Ireland, but to what extent there have been discussions around potential mutual aid being provided by Police Scotland to address any issues that are playing out there, and indeed how you would assess how this could be accommodated alongside what you were talking about right at the outset in terms of concurrency of a whole range of demands on Police Scotland that may make it slightly more difficult to free up the resources that might be requested.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll maybe ask Pat to come in a bit more flavour around just intelligence sharing and relationship management in the island of Ireland, north and south, particularly around the common travel area, and what we've been doing to try and mitigate any risks associated with that. But I'll answer specifically the question around mutual aid. Yeah, we were concerned about significant arrangements made in the early days of Brexit about if we had to send some mutual aid officers across to Northern Ireland. That threat has probably diminished quite significantly over the course of the last 10 or 11 months. And whilst we always sit as part of the wider, what are called the NPOC, the National Police Operations Centre arrangement, for mutual aid to go from Scotland to London, as they did in the earlier part of last year in Northern Ireland, or any other part of the United Kingdom, I think mutual aid this year is more likely to be characterised by mutual aid assets coming to support Scotland and Police Scotland, not least for the COP26 event at the end of the year, where we're bringing thousands, actually, of additional mutual aid officers, both general and public order and specialists, to support us, place this massive event in Glasgow in November. But if I could ask perhaps Pat to cover some of the CTA-based equities and what we're doing in terms of intelligence sharing in that respect. Thank you.
That'd be helpful. Thanks.
Thank you, DCC. A lot of work ongoing in respect of our border vulnerabilities just now. So, as well as sit on Northern Ireland Protocol Group with Home Office and PSNI and the Garda, as well as a number of other partner agencies. So, again, we're well up to date with some of the issues that's transpiring just now. What we have seen is an increase in the traffic coming through the common travel area. So you look at, for example, the Port of Rosslare, or a 470% increase in freight coming through there direct from the EU, bypassing the UK mainland, and thereafter how that thereafter comes through to Northern Ireland and through thereafter into the UK mainland, mainly through Cairn. So again, we're monitoring that just now in respect of such as the criminal use of some of the hauliers. We're well engaged information intelligence sharing with both PSNI and the Garda as well. So weekly meetings with both agencies, with ourselves at this time, doing a bit of information sharing. I'm watching very closely any tensions within Northern Ireland and how that may thereafter manifest itself within Scotland. So again, a lot of work ongoing on a daily and weekly basis around that just now.
That's very helpful, ACC Campbell. Just the volume increases you were talking about there in terms of freight movements through Rosslare, is the expectation that that is now going to be an ongoing trend, and will that therefore require an ongoing commitment of resource from Police Scotland over the medium to longer term, or is it a bit too early to say at this stage?
It's a bit early to say at this stage. I think certainly the traffic coming into Rosslare, for example, it's basically advertised as Brexit buster deals, and they're coming from some of the ports in northern France into Rosslare. What we're not really seeing is any concern coming from the ports of Belfast and Larne into Cairn Ryan at this stage. But again, we are monitoring that very, very closely. In respect to the DCC indicated just right about some of the checks with freight were postponed in Belfast just due to some increased tensions a couple of weeks ago, which are now back on. But they are still basically working out how that will manifest itself within the take-off haulage and freight coming from Northern Ireland into the UK mainland, still within that 6 months period, whereby they're still trying to develop that framework at this particular stage.
Thanks very much. That's all from me, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Liam. Question from Fulton McGregor. Fulton, please.
Thanks, Convener. Just to point out, just in case you've not seen it, I think put an R in. I don't know if it was on this question or not.
Yes, I beg your pardon. Yes, sorry. Mr Kerr, do you wish to come in on this matter?
No, thank you, Convener, for the opportunity, but I'm happy we'll move on.
Forgive me, monitoring all the various bits and pieces here. I missed your request to speak. Thank you. Sorry about that. And thank you, Fulton. Fulton, you have a question, please?
Yeah, it's just a brief question on the response unit. And I know that, you know, it's already been said that it's been the primary responder to matters arising from Brexit. I'm wondering if you can provide a wee bit more detail on the types of work that the Flexible Response Unit has been involved with. And also, I know that it's due to be reviewed in March, well, actually, 1st of March today. It's due to be reviewed this month. What do you expect that review to entail? Do you think it will keep it in its current form, or do you think they have changed it? Thanks.
Thank you. Absolutely. I mean, as you'll remember from the previous session with the subcommittee, the Flexible Response Unit was actually showed the dividends and the value of having a single national police service in Scotland. We had the resilience and the capacity and the flexibility to move across the country as we needed to. And I also outlined the last time we gave evidence to the committee that we had intended to cut the numbers. There were about 300 officers thereabout in the Flexible Response Unit. It's now cut down to about 225 because, as I said at the time, 50 of those officers were from the north of the country, but most of the deployments were in the central belt. So we just didn't think it was fair to retain that capacity from the north when the north wasn't getting the benefit out of it. Since it's been set up in August 19, the Flexible Response Unit, as now called, has been deployed about 34,500 times. The vast majority, practically all of those deployments, haven't been Brexit related. It's just been a national asset that we've been able to move across the country very, very quickly, deal with things like environmental protests, XR protests, to deal with some of the weather issues recently, to respond to the train derailment. There's been a whole range of operational deployments, both normal policing and exceptional policing demand, that have been massively beneficial and significant operational assistance to operational responders across the country. But the specific question about you know, what's going to happen in the review period at the end of March, we're very, very unlikely to stand down the Flexible Response Unit at the end of March. As I was saying in response to one of the convener's questions at the start, we have an incredibly busy event-rich year, and we will need that single national asset to give us that flexibility and resilience across the country. We've been significantly helped by the fact that the £60 million additional revenue investment for 2021-22 as a recurring investment from the Scottish Government has meant that we don't have that structural deficit anymore. So that has significantly helped us with maintaining that capacity and resilience moving forward. So I hope that answers the question, but very happy to go back to any points if I've missed any points of your question out.
No, I'm happy with that, and I'm happy to leave it there, Convener, as well.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Fulton. And indeed, that completes our questions. I'd like to thank you, Mr Kerr, Mr Campbell, indeed your colleagues, for all your work, not only in relation to the challenges that we've been discussing today posed by Brexit, but also particularly in relation to the COVID pandemic. But before we conclude, Mr Kerr, I have an issue that I require to raise with you, and that is about the evidence given to the committee by ACC Williams on the 18th of January on the use of drones. Now, I've read very carefully what Mr Williams said, and particularly note his references in relation to RIPSA and updated assessments. The committee is now in receipt of a revised assessment from Police Scotland, which clearly shows that the intended use of drones is way beyond that outlined by ACC Roy, and includes football matches, demonstrations and the collation of evidence from such locations for the Crown, way beyond searching for missing persons. Members' questions were straightforward, and indeed I pressed the ACC on through the reply on RIPSA. The proposed extended use of drones, however benign in intention, would be like CCTV. It is surveillance to the layperson, and Mr Kerr, you acknowledged the importance of lay interpretation, and it would be a significant escalation. Now, I've had exchanges of correspondence on behalf of the committee with the ACC on this matter, and all that correspondence is in the public domain. As you know, we publish everything. And it would be a matter of grave concern if we'd been given misleading, inaccurate or incomplete information. So can I ask ACC Kerr that you get Police Scotland to check the official report for the 18th of January and advise the committee of any inaccurate, misleading or any incomplete information provided, and that Police Scotland examine the letter sent since that meeting and ensure that the committee is provided with all the information by 5 p.m. this Thursday, please.
Yes, of course you can, Commissioner. I'd be very happy to take that away and do that.
Okay, many thanks indeed, Mr Kerr. And again, thank you to yourself and Mr Campbell for your evidence at today's meeting. And that concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next meeting of the subcommittee will be the final of this session and will take place on Monday, 15th March, when we will take evidence from Martin Evidence, the newly appointed chair of the Scottish Police Authority, along with the soon-to-be-appointed permanent chief executive for the authority. In the meantime, any follow-up scrutiny issues will be dealt with by correspondence, which, as I've just said, will be published on our website. As previously agreed, I'll now move the meeting in private session. Thank you.